Hey everyone, I'm Adam Haritan. I'm hanging out here in the woods and I can't help but notice all this garlic mustard around me. So all of this is Aliaria petiolata. It's a cruciferous plant or a brassica plant, so it's not too distantly related from kale, kohlrabi, Brussels sprouts, and broccoli. Clearly it's non-native. It's a very aggressive plant here in North America. You typically see it in disturbed areas, you see it in shady areas, you see it along the edges of woods, and more you're seeing it in people's lawns and in people's gardens as well. Now you're probably familiar with this plant, especially if you spent any time outside, but maybe you didn't know a few things about garlic mustard that I want to discuss in this video. So that's the topic of today's video, which is a few things that maybe you didn't know about this non-native, very aggressive plant in North America. So without any further introduction on my part, let's get right down to it. So first, where did garlic mustard come from? And how did it get to North America in the first place? And those are great questions to start with. So garlic mustard is native to Europe, and it was brought over in the 1800s by European settlers. It's a culinary and medicinal herb, and it was first documented in North America in 1868 in Long Island, New York. However, it was probably here a little bit before that. So where exactly in Europe did this plant originate from? Because Europe's a pretty big place, and garlic mustard is found all throughout Europe. So was it just brought over from random places in Europe or from one specific spot? So that's a good question, and research has actually looked at that exact question. And they found that the North American populations of garlic mustard, the ones that I'm seeing right here, probably originated from the British Isles region of Europe based on the genetic makeup. And even more interestingly, that multiple introductions of garlic mustard to North America probably took place. So it wasn't just one introduction or two in the 1800s, but multiple introductions specifically from the British Isles region of Europe. Now, why would this plant be brought over here in the first place? Well, as I mentioned before, this plant had been esteemed as a culinary and medicinal herb. Whenever you look at British herbal texts, especially older ones, you see that this plant, garlic mustard, was also known as sauselone and also jack in the hedge. And it was administered and used as a diaphoretic plant, as a diuretic plant, as an antiscorbutic plant. This plant had also been mixed with vinegar and wine to create an antiseptic mixture. So whenever you do see garlic mustard in your next walk in the woods, keep in mind that your population that you're seeing is probably most closely related to the populations found in the British Isles region of Western Europe. The second thing about garlic mustard that I want to mention continues our discussion about the nutritional and medicinal benefits of this plant. So whenever we look at the nutrient composition of garlic mustard, we see that it is an excellent source of vitamin C. So it's not just a good source, it's not just a great source or a very, very great source, but an excellent source of vitamin C because it contains about 190 milligrams of vitamin C per 100 grams of tissue. So let me provide some context. An orange at 100 grams provides about 53 milligrams of vitamin C. So we see that garlic mustard contains 3 to 4 times the amount of vitamin C gram for gram compared to an orange. Well, some of you might be saying, yeah, I'd like to see you sit down and eat 100 grams of garlic mustard because it's nearly impossible. Well, you don't have to do that. Even just by consuming a little bit of garlic mustard, you would be getting an adequate amount of vitamin C. And if you consume more garlic mustard, then you'd be getting more vitamin C. And why is vitamin C essential? Well, because we cannot manufacture it. Your body cannot manufacture vitamin C. And vitamin C acts as an antioxidant by combating free radical damage. Vitamin C also aids in the synthesis of, for example, collagen, which is an important structural protein found in almost every tissue in our body. Vitamin C aids in the synthesis of carnitine, which is a compound that turns fat in your body into energy. So let me say that one more time. Carnitine turns fat into energy. And who doesn't want more of that? Vitamin C has also been shown to aid in the synthesis of catecholamines, which are chemicals that act as neurotransmitters and hormones. So just by consuming some of the garlic mustard aerial portions, we are consuming an adequate amount of vitamin C. Whenever we consume this plant, we're also getting a class of compounds into our bodies known as glucosinolates. These glucosinolates are enzymatically broken down into compounds known as isothiocyanates. Now, you might not know what that term means or what it's all about, but perhaps you've tasted it or smelled it before. Whenever you crush garlic mustard leaves or whenever you break up any wild mustard or even some of the cultivated mustards and you smell those mustard oils, those are isothiocyanates that you're smelling. And these compounds have physiological effects in our bodies. And numerous studies show that these compounds have antimicrobial effects in our bodies, they have anti-carcinogenic properties, anti-tumor properties, and they also help our livers detoxify foreign compounds much more easily by working with a system known as the phase 2 enzyme system within our livers. Now keep in mind that isothiocyanates may present some problems in individuals, especially by preventing the uptake of iodine into the thyroid. So if you're prone to those kind of conditions, maybe look into not consuming so many mustards, especially wild garlic mustard. But for the majority of the population, majority of healthy individuals, consuming a little bit of garlic mustard seems to provide healthy benefits to the body. The third thing I want to mention about garlic mustard deals with those glucosinolates that we talked about, but in a pretty different way. So glucosinolates are secreted from garlic mustard into the soil, and what these compounds do is they actually prevent native mycorrhizal fungi and native plants from growing and reproducing. And this phenomenon is known as allelopathy. They secrete chemicals in the soil that inhibit the growth, the spread, the reproduction of native species. And that's how garlic mustard is able to gain a stronghold in its ecosystem. Now, the compound is specifically known as sinigrin, and that's a glucosinolate compound. So that compound does have beneficial effects for our bodies, but it also deters native mycorrhizal fungi and native plants from colonizing this area. But what's really, really interesting is that it seems that as the populations age, as garlic mustard populations get older, that production of sinigrin goes down and stops completely. And native mycorrhizal fungi are able to move back in, and native plants are able to move back in as well. So it seems that garlic mustard populations are self-regulating and actually die out over time. Now, all of this information was recently published in a study in the journal Functional Ecology in the year 2016. And the researchers discussed essentially what I already described, that younger populations of garlic mustard gain their competitive advantage by secreting a compound known as sinigrin, it's a glucosinolate compound, into the soil, deters the fungi and the plants, the native fungi and native plants, from inhabiting this area. So it kills them off. And then as this population ages over 20 to 30 years, the garlic mustard stops producing sinigrin. It doesn't need to produce it anymore because there's a heavy fitness cost to producing that compound. Whenever they stop producing this compound, then the native mycorrhizal fungi move back in, the native plants move back in as well. So over a timetable of maybe 20 to 30 years, it seems that garlic mustard is a self-regulating plant. Now, of course, I'm not saying we shouldn't pull it every chance we get. We shouldn't eat it every chance we get. I'm just saying that research shows that this plant is self-regulating, and over 20 to 30 years, this plant does tend to die off, and the mycorrhizal fungi and the native plants move back in. Now, the fourth and final thing I want to mention about garlic mustard involves one of the primary reasons this plant is so successful here in North America, beyond its production of sinigrin into the soil. And you know what that reason is? Well, it's a native species that really helps garlic mustard thrive. So what is that native species? Well, it's not a plant, it's not a mushroom, it's not even a slime mold, it's an animal. The animal is the white-tailed deer. So one of the primary reasons that garlic mustard is so successful and prevalent is the overpopulation of white-tailed deer. You see, the density of deer in the U.S. is 4 to 10 times what it was prior to European settlement of North America. And without deer, garlic mustard populations are projected to decline to extinction. So those aren't my words or thoughts. These thoughts have been published in various studies and various journals. For example, here in Pittsburgh, in the University of Pittsburgh, they published a study out of the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in 2014 showing just that the more deer that are in an area, the more garlic mustard there is. And the less deer, the less garlic mustard there is. Also in the journal AOB Plants in the year 2017, so very recent study, showed the same thing, that deer don't feed on garlic mustard. They feed on native plants instead. And if the native plants were around, if there are a lot of them, they could collectively outcompete non-native plants, including garlic mustard. So all of this lends support to a theory known as biotic resistance, which is the ability of a native community to keep out invasive species through combined collective advantages. So if there were a lot of native plant species, collectively they could outcompete non-native understory species, including garlic mustard. Now keep in mind that deer isn't the primary reason. It's not just like an overpopulation of deer is the primary reason. It's a primary reason, but probably not the primary reason that native plants don't exist in levels that they used to. I mean, we're looking at massive development, we're looking at massive industry, also agriculture, that's just wiping out a lot of the native species. And so all these combined forces, you're looking at industry, development, agriculture, you're looking at overpopulation of deer, you're looking at the production of sinigrin, all of these combined help garlic mustard really, really thrive here in North America. Thanks for watching this video. I truly appreciate it. I hope you learned something about garlic mustard, Aliaria petiolata, one of the most persistent plants in the understory woods of North America. I'm going to spend the rest of the afternoon harvesting some of these greens for food, doing my part to assist in the health not only of this land, but in the health of my body as well. And I invite you to do the same. Thanks again. Take care.